Ham Radio Now, episode 212, the 212. We're in the New York area code. You know how they figured out those area codes back in the old days? It's because of the old rotary dial phones. You remember those, right? Most of the guys in this audience are going to remember rotary. Well, for the young guys. For the young guys, maybe you don't. Here's how they worked. No. That's wrong old rotary dial phone. Let's get the right one up here. Yeah, that's it. So you had to stick your finger in there and go round and round and round. And for the area code, at least, for all the, where all the people were, the big cities, you didn't want to have to go round and round and round for, you know, area codes like that. So New York got 212. Chicago was 312, Detroit 313. Now, I live in the middle of no place. You know, back when they did the area codes, Raleigh, North Carolina, this whole area, which is 919, that's where Barney Fife went on vacation, you know, from Mayberry, went to Raleigh and stayed at the YMCA. So now we're in the in the 919. Fortunately, with the touch tone dialing, and no one actually dials numbers anymore with our phones, we usually tell the phone what number to dial, or at least it's all speed dial stuff. Why do we even call it dialing? We haven't dialed in decades. Where was I? Oh, yeah. Episode 212. You know why they call it? What are we going to call this one? Because there's a lot of stuff here, and it's not one thing, like a typical Ham Radio Now episode. In a lot of shows, they just pick one cute thing from somewhere in the show, and they do it at the end of the show, and they call the episode based on the one cute thing, but it's got a lot of other stuff in it. So let me see what else we got here. Nothing's really standing out. Nothing. Forget this episode. Nothing is really cute. It's just a lot of random stuff. Okay. Ham Radio Now, episode 212. Lots of random stuff. Yeah, okay, we'll go with that. It's been a while since I've done an episode, and it might not be a while before I do another one, but I just kind of had to throw this one together. I've got a lot of stuff in the hopper. Still a couple things from Dayton yet to put together, but I haven't had time to work on it because I've been working on a lot of other things. Not Ham Radio Now type stuff. There's a lot of stuff going on. So those are going to keep me busy for a while, although there's some things I want to get done. There's always things that I want to get done. Let's see. It would be time for me to point back to Arvin and mention that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you, but there's something a little more important that I need to bring up here. 9 days to go as I record this, 9 days to go on the Kickstarter. This is the Kickstarter that would get me out to Chicago, my old hometown, my kind of town, and record the Tapper Digital Communications Conference. So 9 days to go, and we are less than halfway to the $10,000 goal. Let's see how we're doing there. Let's see, the $10 level for rewards, 10 backers, the $25 level is 11. 50 bucks because 9 people signed up, 100 bucks has 2, but the 150, where you get all the programs on a USB stick, that's got... 10. And finally, the big one, the big $500 corporate level has 3. Okay, where were we again? Oh, 4,480 out of the $10,000 total. And 9 days to go as I record this. It will finish on July 31st. At 11:59 p.m. Now, I know Kickstarters typically have a surge at the end, but that's going to have to be a pretty big surge. So I'm not sure what the possibilities for that are. Once again, I will remind you that to get the corporate backers, I kind of set that up for small ham radio businesses, mid-sized ham radio businesses, or other businesses that would like to have their name associated with the videos for the Tapper Conference. And once again, this is the Kickstarter is for doing the video, not for the Tapper Conference itself. That's funded by Tapper members and folks who attend the conference. So the Kickstarter is for doing the video, and the $500 corporate level gets you a mention, kind of, you know, enhanced underwriting is what they call it on PBS. Talk about you for a little while at the beginning of some of the programs, depending on how many underwriters we get. And I'm not going to go chasing these guys. I have sent email out to everybody advertising in QST, everybody advertising in CQ, and I've sent email to all those folks. And I'm not going to chase any harder. If you have contacts in any business, it's going to be up to you if you're somebody interested in getting Ham Radio Now out there to do the Tapper video. Make these contacts. Point out where we are. And you can find the link at hamradionow.tv. You know, that's easy to find. And there's the Kickstarter link. So find that pretty easily. Yes, I would like to go. But doing this has been primarily a something that has been requested by the ham radio community, the Tapper community, folks who want to see the conference either because they can't get there or because, as you've discovered, it's a great way to review and to have an archive of all this stuff. And I'm happy to do it, but I am not happy to do it for free, and I'm not happy to do it as a labor of love. For me, this is a business. So these days, and somebody made a comment, I had put a note someplace, it might have been on a QRZ comment or, you know, somewhere that said, look at all the outfits that do this stuff for free. It's a volunteer deal. Other forums at Dayton have been covered for free by the Hamvention, some by ICOM, some by other outfits. Meetings and forums, things like that, other places are done without somebody sticking their hand out saying, send me money to do this. And that's fine. If this Kickstarter doesn't work and I'm not going to Chicago this year for the Tapper Conference, perhaps they can find one of these volunteer efforts. Most of them, they don't do the same quality, you know, multi-camera and really good audio and all that stuff. They're getting better. You know, in the early days, they were really terrible. Somebody would set up a camera in the back of the room, and you'd hear somebody with a lot of room ambience. It would sound terrible. But, you know, pictures are easy to get. Sound can be harder to get. But it would be a single camera, and maybe they would kind of jerkily pan from the person talking over to the slides or whatever. If they were working really hard, then they got a copy of the PowerPoint and edited them in. And I don't do that because that's a lot of work. So I bring an extra camera and I just switch back and forth. Plus people walk up to the slide and point at it. So I get that. And if they just edit in the PowerPoint, they don't get the person walking up and pointing. They don't get the laser pointer, things like that. Okay. So there's other ways to do it, but it's not going to be me. So if the Kickstarter works, there we go. I'll be there. And I'll be happy to be there. And if it doesn't make it, we won't despair. We'll just look for, well, Tapper and you will look for another way to do it. Okay, moving on. What's next? ARL just got done with a board meeting. I got a note on that. Yep, here it is from their ARL's website. Yes, a dues hike. Not sure I would have put it that way. The word hike, yes, it would always appear in a headline from a newspaper, independent source. But the folks that are doing it, they don't want to call it a hike. Dues increase. Their headline writer says it's a hike, so I guess it'll be a hike. It's going up $10 from $39 to $49. It's been $39 since 2001. So, you know, they need it. And when you wait that long to have a dues increase, it's going to be substantial to make a difference. And they don't have a senior discount, because if they had a senior discount, 95% of the members would be eligible for it. So I exaggerate, but they don't have a senior discount, and that's why. Yes, please stand by.
Who have I got this time?
Oh, this time it is the mouse. And here she is. Say hi to everybody, mouse, and climb up there. The mouse may stay up there for a little while. And she may jump down and then come bug me again in a couple of minutes. Dave Sumner, K1ZZ, is going to be retiring as CEO next May. So they're looking for a new CEO. And maybe the big deal from the board meeting is that they have approved their the draft of the band plan. And that was, there we go. They proposed this earlier this year, changing the HF band plan. This is the voluntary band plan, mostly, although they've got some things that they may be petitioning the FCC to do. It's too big. Most of it is bandwidth of digital stations. That's the big concern in this. And it's too detailed for me to talk about in any kind of depth right now. So maybe we'll do a whole show on it. It deserves a whole show. I need to get some, guests from the league to be able to talk about it in detail. Does anybody pay attention to the band plans? The voluntary ones? Some. Yeah, I know there are some. Kind of wonder if it gets a lot of attention. The other thing that's going on, the big thing that's going on, is the Amateur Radio Parity Act. That's parity with a T, not parody with a D. And it has picked up a Senate version. And that's a big deal. I didn't expect it. I really didn't expect that to happen this year. It's a very positive development. Remember the I'm Just a Bill on Capitol Hill thing? I should have had that queued up. I don't have it ready. I don't think I'm going to bother editing it in either. But in order for a bill to become a law, it's got to be passed in both houses of Congress. Here's the mouse. It's got to be passed by the House, and there was the House bill, H.R. 1301, and the exact same language has to be passed by the Senate. So now there's the Senate bill, 1685. It was introduced by Republican Senator Roger Wicker from Mississippi. And I've got a program tentatively lined up to record next week. I don't have a real schedule for it next week. It's going to be with ARRL Chief Counsel Chris Imlay, W3KD, and Hudson Division Director Mike Lysenko. Mike is into YBB. And they've both been deeply involved in stalking the halls of Washington. No, stalking's the wrong word. Walking the halls of Washington, making these contacts, talking to legislators, along with a bunch of other ARRL officials that we've been hearing from, or hearing about. So hopefully going to be able to talk to them and do a program and learn. And we'll tell you what to do about it. Information's on the ARRL website about what to do about it as an individual ham, but we'll try to motivate you and accidentally educate you, I think, the way that I put it to them, by talking about how this came about, getting some stories about how these guys actually talked to legislators and lined up senators. So this is pretty cool. The Roger Wicker thing, though, it's interesting to me. This is Roger Wicker's website as a senator, and he is backing or sponsored the original sponsor of the Senate bill, 1685. He is a conservative Republican. As you might expect, being the senator from Mississippi, a pretty conservative state, and in previous Ham Radio Now programs and in a lot of comments on QRZ and a lot of other places, conservative hams not in favor of the Amateur Radio Parity Act. So I point this out only because it's an interesting thing to be aware of. Not every conservative ham is opposed to the Parity Act. You know, the Parity Act is what would bring the PRB1 antenna protections such as they are, the requirement that governments, municipalities, and states provide reasonable accommodation to ham radio antennas. That is never applied to individual contracts, the codes, covenants, and restrictions that many of our homes are covered by in neighborhoods, neighborhood associations rules. The Parity Act would bring the requirement for them to provide reasonable accommodation to amateur radio antennas into those private contracts, basically overriding bits of those contracts that might say no ham radio antennas at all, or have kind of an ambiguous and we get to decide, you know, there's no recourse. You can ask for an antenna. If we say no, it's no. It would get in there, get in the middle a little bit, and make them consider it and, you know, worst comes to worst, give you some recourse if you decided to take things to court. So that's where that all is. But the other thing about Senator Wicker is that he is not a fan of net neutrality. And these two things to me seem to be somewhat opposite sides of the same coin. You know, it's the government intrusion into private stuff. So he would favor the Amateur Radio Parity Act, but he's not a big fan of net neutrality. And a lot of us who are internet fans kind of like the idea of net neutrality. I'm on the, like a lot of people, I'm kind of on the fence of what the FCC is doing, because the FCC has decided to, and this is a done deal, at least for now, the FCC has imposed some net neutrality rules on internet providers, and deciding that the internet providers are like the phone companies now, like common carriers, bringing them into a potentially really serious amount of regulation. But the FCC has said, we're not going to do all that. We're going to keep a light touch on the regulation and just keep things a little more fair for small people, us users from being caught in the wars between the Netflixes and the Comcasts. I'm not much of an expert on all of that, but I've been watching with interest. In any case, Senator Wicker's not a fan of the net neutrality thing. He says it's a bad idea. You can check out his website for his details. Is that it for that subject? I think I've gone far enough on that. What do I want to talk about next? Let's talk about view counts. Let's talk about ham radio now. Things have been trending up just a little bit. Let's see. Where's my over-the-shoulder? There we go. This 211, the last one. Adventures of a Hacker Turned Ham. Over 2,000. The Introduction to DMR, over 2,000. Goodbye to Bill, well over 2,000. What Field Day is Really All About. You know, that one is almost at 4,000 views right now. You know why that is? It's because the public relations people were involved. The folks who know how to get the word out. The folks, you know, Sean, KX9X, the PR guy from headquarters, and Katie, WY7YL, the PR committee. You know, you get those folks involved, and they know how to get the word out because, you know, PR is their deal. Let's look at a couple others. Tapper forums, the videos have not been too bad. These are the ones from Dayton. And by the way, they're not paid for by a Kickstarter. They're just ordinary Ham Radio Now contributions. But if you're going to think about making a contribution this week, don't make it direct to Ham Radio Now. Go to the Kickstarter. Help that out, especially if you're one of the Tapper people. So the Tapper stuff has never had like huge views, generally not huge views. Some of the programs get big views, but not a lot of them. This one over here, this Navassa Fever, I'm disappointed that It hasn't gone past 1,000 views at least, because it's kind of fun. It's an interview with the fella that did a Navassa Island de-expedition back in 1972, and a friend of his shot as much as you can on a Super 8 film. You can't shoot hours and hours of that stuff. It will cost you an arm and a leg. But he documented some of it. He had Wayne Green, W2NSD, was on that de-expedition. So they showed what Navassa was like back in 1972, and then he narrated it and put it on the web. And then I talked to him about his experience, and 700 and where did it go? Oh, it's up to 801. Okay, 801 of you watched it. The Navassa talk itself from the Hamvention is at 1800. And this next one is another one that I'm kind of disappointed hasn't seen more. It just crossed 1,000 views. But the talk by Don Miller, W9WNV, that really deserves more too. Because Don was a big DXer back in the 1960s, fairly controversial. And he's doing some mea culpas about some of the things that he did. That got him and some of his expeditions delisted by the ARL, so they wouldn't count for DXCC, which is a big deal. So he was talking about some of that. He realizes why some of them shouldn't count, because he never actually set foot on the island, but he's complaining that a lot of other de-expeditions never did, and they've been counted. And some of the ones that he said were completely legit got delisted. So it's an interesting talk, and I'm surprised that more people haven't seen it. I'm disappointed that all of the videos aren't getting more views. You know, I still think I should be in the 10,000 range, but we're not. I think I got a video up here from somebody. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, this is a video that's getting 17,000 views. You know, that's the kind of viewership I think most of my program should get. What was this? What was this phenomenal video that got tremendous views? Unboxing and initial thoughts of the Bofeng UV5R portable two-way ham radio. Well, okay, undoubtedly, this is an awesome program.
Hey, everybody, it's Reb. Got a little unboxing. I've been waiting for this thing for a while now.
Oh, I see my problem. I don't have a model posing as a letter carrier in her underwear at the beginning of my programs, so that's clearly the problem.
Steel Spartan. And let's see what the...
Well, it is high def. I'm also not appealing to the God, Guns, and Guts crowd. And there is his Bofeng. Well, okay. Yeah, you can go watch that if you want to see more of it. But one of the reasons why that video has gotten the views is it wasn't aimed at ham radio. It was aimed at preppers. He's a prepper guy, and he's showing prepper guys how to get a ham radio set up. So... Okay, so I was watching a new podcast by Christian Kudnick, K0ST. I got his call sign later on. We'll talk about his program a little bit later on. It's called 100 Watts in a Wire, which, by the way, is exactly what I've got set up here back there. The ICOM 756 Pro 3, 100 watts, although I don't think it's doing that anymore. I think the watt meter shows about 80 these days. Remember, Jeff and I changed the finals out. And I got a 150-foot dipole, 100 watts on a wire. What a great name for a podcast, though. Makes me think Ham Radio Now wasn't such a great find. In his last episode, Christian made the comment about numbers. He said, if you live by the numbers, you die by the numbers. So, okay. Well, Christian, the people who say that are the people who have big numbers or are not worried about them. He's got advertisers. I need people contributing to the program, to the Kickstarter right now. Next, Reddit. somebody made a comment somewhere. I get input from so many different directions, and I often can't remember where they came from. It could be a YouTube comment. I think it was a YouTube comment from one of the programs that said, pay more attention to Reddit. So I signed up on Reddit and I got an account. Reddit, well, that's the ham radio version. Let me look at all for a second here. Reddit is a big old bulletin board. If you've been around for a while, then you remember what bulletin boards were. And Reddit, in fact, looks fairly old school, kind of bulletin board-ish. It's been in the news lately because they've had some testy conflicts between the moderators and Reddit fired, I think it was a woman who was leading the volunteer moderators, and then the moderators rebelled and shut down a lot of the what they call subreddits, pieces of the bulletin board dedicated to specific topics or interests. And now the CEO is quitting. I guess it was an interim CEO, and a guy who founded it is stepping back in for a while. If you listen to tech news very much, you've heard about what's going on with Reddit these days. And they've got a ham radio Reddit subreddit, and I don't think any of that was affected by the brouhaha that was going on with the main Reddit. I don't think that it got shut down or anything like that. So they have the ham radio thing, and it's pretty interesting. It has, I got my cursor on the wrong thing. Let's try this again here. Here we go. Lots of posts, lots of members. People can stick up posts. The posts are moderated to some extent, but the initial post goes right up. You don't wait for someone to approve it. The moderators have been keeping the flame wars at bay in Reddit in general. Those of you that have been around the internet for a long time, and not just ham radio, but it was pretty bad on ham radio. There were the use groups, the use nets, and they deteriorated into just chaos, name calling and crap. And to the point where if you wanted to do something serious, if you wanted to post a topic and get worthwhile feedback on it, the signal to noise was so bad that about 5% of anything that was on there was worth looking at. And so, other things developed. And things that are going to stay reasonable have to be moderated, and that means somebody has to decide what stays and what goes and where they're going to draw the line. Okay, the mouse is back. Let's try sitting here for a little while. Okay, mouse? Yeah, just stay right there. See if I can push my buttons and let the mouse sit. I kind of got a holder. She won't stay by her own. So the Reddit gets moderated. Now, Reddit has places that are pretty nasty places to hang out, but you don't accidentally come across them very easily. You got to go looking for them. So the ham radio part, I haven't found to be much of a problem. If there's a problem, it's just that it's just kind of random. The signal to noise now becomes a question of, are the signals worth watching or worth reading? They're not nasty, they're not evil, but they're just kind of . But some of them are really good, and that's all going to be in the eye of the beholder. And your decision as a reader, are there things that you want to look at? I have found a lot of people asking questions, and a lot of the answers that that are posted are really not very well resourced. They can be wrong. I'm not looking at this one because that's the case. I just grabbed this one kind of at random. There's a lot of bad information that appears and the bad information and the good information kind of get mixed in together. Now, the answers can be voted up and down. That's one of Reddit's things. You decide if you like something, and if you like it, you vote it up, and oh, it's cute here on the ham radio one. The up is a little antenna, and the down is a little ground thing. In the general Reddit world, let's see. Yeah, just arrows, up and down arrows. But in the ham radio Reddit world, it's little antennas and ground things. Yeah, it's pretty good. Yeah, so none of my family care about this. I built my first antenna and it works. Nothing sexy. You know, so, they're just stories of ordinary hams and questions by ordinary hams. I find, again, a lot of them are at a pretty low rudimentary level. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with that. What I would like to see are better answers. And the first time I got on there, I posted answers to about five or six, and then Reddit came back and said, take a break, guy. You've been working pretty hard. Somebody said it was because I was new and had only logged on recently, and they were kind of throttling me a little bit by algorithm, not by a human. It wasn't a human who was saying stand by. It just their algorithm says if you're new, you probably shouldn't be posting something on every post that you decide to comment on, and you know, spending hours at it. Just take a break. So I guess I'm not too upset about that. It's just something that I noticed. I posted a topic on Reddit here. I posted a notice of the episode, 211, with Michael Osman, The Adventures of a Hacker Turned Ham. And I think Reddit doesn't really want a lot of just sort of publicity posts. Things like, there's a new episode of Ham Radio Now up, so go watch it. I don't think they want that. I don't see a lot of things like that. So although I mentioned in the post that it was a new episode, I tried to put a lot of other things in there. I do the same thing on amateurradio.com. Amateurradio.com is another blog post that invited me to participate. And so I do now and then. But I don't just announce episodes. If I'm going to spend some time, I'll spend some time and write something that goes beyond just the fact that there's going to be an episode put up there. So I did that here. And I buried what I wanted to be my lead, which is, do hams have any visibility in the young hacker community? And this is something that I've mentioned before, and I'm going to mention again, and I'm going to ask people. I tried to ask Sean and Katie about this, and then I got distracted. Squirrel! Went on to something else. But you know, there's a lot of tech sites, a lot of blogs, but mostly I'm thinking of programs, podcasts, audio podcasts, video podcasts. There's a lot of them out there oriented to tech, and very few of them talk very much about ham radio. Obviously, Twit, which is probably the biggest, has got Ham Nation. And Leo occasionally talks about ham radio and some of the other programs. But there's a lot of others out there. And most of them never talk about ham radio at all. I've never heard anyone talking about it, except for John C. Dvorak and Adam Curry on the No Agenda show, because they're both hams. And they actually talk, especially Adam, talks about ham radio very positively. He doesn't talk about anything positively on that show, except for ham radio. He seems to like us. He's contributed to the Kickstarters for Tapper and stuff, and to the program in general. Someday I want to get the courage to ask him on as a guest, because I'm afraid he would shred me. Probably not, because he likes hams and he likes the show. He's got that value for value model where if you like the show, you give him some money, and people give his show a lot of money. Anyway, so I was asking this question in this community, and I got a little bit of feedback on it. There were a lot of comments in general about young people in ham radio, most of the usual comments, some of them trending toward, if you're going to interest them, it's got to be the new ham radio. It's got to be digital stuff, not the old ham radio, the contests and sideband and things like that. But not everybody felt that way. You know, there's a lot of value in the lack of infrastructure. The kids don't get the idea of lack of infrastructure because the infrastructure just about never goes down for them anymore. So they're not that excited about the idea that we can communicate, albeit in a somewhat more limited and specialized fashion, without phone lines, without internet. Wait till they get the next hurricane. Well, okay. Some of them are too young. So there were some good comments on that. I only got a couple of comments specifically addressing media, and you know, the sample size was too small, but they're basically saying that the really young folks don't watch that new media, the, you know, technical podcasts either. So it's kind of, you know, the middle, probably, you know, starting at the upper 20s and into the 30s. And Twit itself, I've heard Leo admit that Twit is on the older side of the tech audience. You know, they're probably 30s, 40s, and 50s. And you know, so they're going to miss a lot of the 20s. And none of this is to say there are no people in their 20s watching that stuff. That would be like saying there are no people in their 20s and teens in ham radio. Clearly there are. They're just not as many as we would like there to be. There aren't enough for a future of ham radio unless we find some more. Reddit led me to somebody interesting, though. When I was first just getting into it, there was this little post, and I followed up on it, and not very many other people had followed up on it, and it led me to somebody kind of interesting. I'll tell you what, I'm going to play a couple different pieces of video from this talk that the Reddit post led me to, but before I say anything more about it, I'm just going to let it get you mad.
We're not loosening up any specifications that affect quality or safety, but we're getting rid of all the ham radio specs, and that lowers costs, right?
Okay. Who is that guy?
So I'm Paul Elio, CEO of Elio Motors, and we're here to talk about the innovation in the project tonight.
All right, Paul Elio, CEO of Elio Motors, and this is the car that he's talking about, this little three-wheeler. You know, it's going to be a, if it gets, you know, into full production and it becomes popular, it could be interesting. He's trying to tell everybody that it's safe and something you should be interested in for economy, particularly. It's inexpensive, great fuel mileage, all that stuff. And I got a feeling that hams would be interested in this if he weren't goring our ox. So to get a better idea of where he's really going, let me back up a little bit and play the comment that leads up to what he was talking about with ham radio in more context, the context of his suppliers.
How the game works is the supplier quotes the business at a number that they can't make money on, and they win the business. They count on engineering changes to occur. They overcharge for the engineering changes so they can get the price up to something they can live with, and millions of dollars get spent on both sides playing this game trying to come up with a fair number. Our deal with every supplier is cost plus 20%. So if their sales, general, and administrative expenses are in line, they make double-digit margins on Elio and single-digit margins on everything else. So how do you hit this low price point when you're letting the suppliers make money? And that is through proper design and proper specifications. So on specifications, my VP of supply chain supplies a lighted cup holder to one of the major OEMs, and he gave them the first article. And they did the EMF testing, and it interfered with the ham radio band. And they said, you know, Steve, you need to redesign this. He's like, when was the last time somebody put a ham radio in one of your products? And the design engineer said, I don't care. It doesn't meet the spec. Redesign it. So he charged him for a redesign, and he's charged him more for every single part so it meets that spec. And in fairness to that design engineer, he had two choices. He could spend the next 90 days of his career rewriting that spec, and if he made a mistake, possibly lose his job, or hand the part back to Steve and say, it doesn't meet the spec. So I had that speech with every single supplier when they got engaged in the project, and every single one of them sighed and list off the top of their head three or four things they are forced to do that the customer just doesn't care about, that cost them money and anguish. And so by we're not loosening up any specifications that affect quality or safety, but we're getting rid of all the ham radio specs. And that lowers costs, right?
Yeah. So like I said, if he weren't goring our ox about ham radio and emissions, a lot of us, I think, would probably go right on. Good on you. So, well, what are the rules for EMI in cars? You know, I don't really know. I'm pretty sure they're covered by the FCC, like everything else. And I'm not sure he can just say, we're not going to worry about that. You know, sooner or later, something like that might catch up with him. I don't know. I probably ought to talk to Ed Hare about that and find out what because he deals with people in the industry all the time. You know, W1RFI, the lab manager up at ARL headquarters, Ed Hare. He deals with that sort of thing all the time and works with companies that have EMI issues. But, you know, that's not really my point in bringing all this to you here in the audience. My point is that this is another example of how we ham radio operators are seen out there in the real world. And in this case, even somewhat the technical world. You know, we are seen as the pointy-headed, pedantic, narrowly focused engineer types who are out of touch with reality. And what is the reality? I mean, does he have a good point about how many ham radios are going to appear in his cars? Can the world afford to protect ham radio from a lot of interference? You know, the conventional wisdom in ham radio circles is that putting EMI mitigation in devices is pennies per device. And when you're talking about millions of devices that a company might sell, that adds up to some real money. But it you know, if they added it in the pennies per device or per whatever, per unit, if you added that into the consumer cost, it'd be irrelevant. So I don't know. That's the conventional ham radio wisdom, but he seems to think that it's significantly bigger deal than that. But on the other hand, I got a feeling we're just being the whipping boy. You know, he can point to us and kind of, you know, that little laugh that he did. And he's generate some, oh yeah, it's those hams, you know, they're just costing us money for no really good purpose. And that is trouble for us. So, when the ARL invokes or is talking about EMI, they try not to talk about just ham radio. They try to invoke other services, particularly things that are going to affect the general public, like broadcast services or public safety radio services. If it's going to bother us, it's going to bother them. And so it's not just ham radio. All right, well, stay tuned. Probably going to be more on that. I'll see if I can beat that little horse into the ground in some way. Let's do something a little bit more fun. Let's play some music. Can't play much music. The guys in Australia are going to be mad if I play a lot of music here, but there was a little bit in that intro to the car. Okay, let's play a little bit more.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Herman thought she fell in love when she looked into his eyes. How was he to know she had something else in mind? She was checking out his rigs, sizing up his radio shack.
Now, I unfortunately can't play a lot of this without doing some talking over it, because it is got the standard YouTube license, which means I'm not authorized to just play it at a will. When did this come out? Let's see. Oh, 2012. So it's been out for a couple of years. I came across it, I don't know, probably a few months ago.
She had a secret storage unit with ham equipment.
Wall to wall. I played it enough that I know the words.
Well, she's a
Ham Radio Hoarder. The disc jockeys aren't supposed to sing along with the music. Not get
she never desired a human's heart. She just wanted all his stuff.
I was blown away. This is not awesome video production. You know, it's pretty good video production. It's awesome music. And it's not the only one that these guys have produced. Let's see. Okay, I'm going to have to stop that. And let's see. This is the YouTube channel that it comes from. It's called Brain Trusts. And the About section doesn't really say very much. Mostly amateur radio videos, some Navy videos. My wife June's lovely singing voice is on all but the Navy videos. This is the guy who put it up there. Paul, sorry, Paul, I can't pronounce your name. I think it's a Polish name. You'd think that somebody who lives in this area with Duke University and Coach Mike Krzyzewski, whose name I can pronounce. Here's the bear. It was the mouse before. Now it's the bear. Bear will sit on my lap for a while. You'd think that a guy who lives in an area with Coach K, Mike Krzyzewski, you know, I can just say that trips right off my tongue. I worked on a commercial one time a while ago where they made a joke. It was a guy, I think a guy looking for a chauffeur, picking him up at the airport, Mr. Krzyzewski. So the thing is, we all know how to say Krzyzewski, but we don't know how we got there. We say it because we all learned how. We watch TV. Paul, I don't know how to pronounce your name. In any case, Paul lives over in Mount Juliet, Tennessee, K4PEW. I can say his call sign. And sure enough, there's the videos that he did. So he's the guy that did that. His wife, June, is the woman who sang the music. And I encourage you to go by their website and play them. Now, the Ham Radio Hoarder, to me, is the best of the group. And I think it's the most recent, so you know, getting some practice in there. And I'm surprised that I hadn't come across it before. You know, when it first came out, it just hasn't gotten a lot of publicity. It probably got mentioned once on QRZ.com. And I'll mention it here, and maybe a few more people will go look. It's a lot of fun. So, Ham Radio Hoarder. Let's stick with the media. Mentioned Christian Kudnick and his podcast, 100 Watts and a Wire. Great name, Christian. Great name. I thought Ham Radio Now was good, but it feels kind of generic compared to this. This is brand new. He's only got his fifth episode out. And he has a co-host. The co-host is Katie Allen, WY7YL. And you saw Katie here on Ham Radio Now fairly recently. That's me pointing at her in episode 208, what Field Day is really all about, along with Sean Kutzko, KX9X. And so Christian has picked up Katie as his co-host, and they, once again, podcasts, any kind of media, is in the eye, or in this case, it's an audio podcast, the ear of the listener.
Support for 100 Watts and a Wire is brought to you by ICOM. Get out. Get mobile with ICOM.
It's got sponsors.
Visit ICOMAmerica.com.
Okay, I'll listen to his other sponsor, too.
Ever wonder why so many people mention QRZ.com when they're on the air?
I've mentioned it several times in this podcast.
Welcome to 100 Watts and a Wire. I'm Christian K0STH with Katie Allen.
The thing that I like is that they are just bantering, just being very casual. They'll probably do interviews and things like that down the road.
I mean, it only makes sense. And, I mean, Bob helps you out with that.
But to me, they feel like I'm just eavesdropping on the conversation of a couple guys having a good conversation. Now, I've aimed at that to some extent in the Ham Radio Now programs, but and we're not super stiff and formal. So many ham radio programs are really stiff and overly formal, but this is anything but.
Right, episode 573, you'll have it down pat.
Yes, in breaking news, so I've just signed Katie Allen, WY7YL, for 500 more episodes. So yeah. There we go. Or did you say 500?
This episode, their episode number 5, I think it is, is called Lanny and Mom. This show's for you. And the reason that that it is for them is because Lanny is one of his mentors, a listener to the podcast, and it was Katie's mom. And they had some criticism of the show. I don't remember which one said which, and I probably have this not quite right because I'm just kind of remember, but it was kind of like, well, it's a little slow, you know, it's not hammy enough. You know, too much non-ham stuff, like probably about 25% of what they talk about is not ham radio. Well, I love that, but you might. It's the kind of thing that can divide an audience, and I've got that. You know, when I do something that is not ham radio, I will get people that say, I just love that you do something that is not just plain ham radio, that you talking to Jeff or anybody else about other stuff. And I get folks who say, in fact, I get Jeff who say in the middle of the episode, what about the ham radio now? All right. So, my phone is ringing, but it's appears to be a, telemarketer. So we'll just let it go. You might be able to hear it in the background. The other thing that they have been doing, though, is they've been pushing really hard on their Facebook page. And I've got a Facebook page. You know, there's the Ham Radio Now Facebook page. And I've used it to announce when episodes are coming up. What I didn't realize until I looked at their Facebook page is that on mine, you can't post anything. You can make comments, but you can't post something. If you want to add something to the page, it shows up over here in the corner. And, you know, does anybody actually see that? And not very many people do. So what they've got is not a Facebook page per se. They've got what Facebook calls a group. And here, although most of the posts that I'm seeing are from Christian, there we go, Jeff Boyd has posted something. And, you know, anybody who's a member of the group can stick anything up there that they want. And it's very interactive, and they talk about it a lot. And they get more real time about it. I don't use Facebook in any kind of real time. I took it off my phone back when it was accused of being a battery hog. I could probably put it back on my phone. I try not to be that, you know, curmudgeon, get off the lawn, you Facebook rating kids. I try not to be that kind of curmudgeon. There was a point when a lot of us would just consider it to be an utter waste of time. And it's not. It can be. People can get way too addicted to it and spend way too much time on it. But it can also be just some, you know, just some place where you go connect with friends and family. And I don't really have time to do that. At least I haven't made time. It's not something that I've made a priority. So, but I have made a Ham Radio Now Facebook group. And it's available for you if you want to join it. And my Facebook page has got a link that I've stuck up there. It's going to sit for a while, to the Ham Radio Now group. I was surprised that Facebook let me do two things and call them both Ham Radio Now, but I did. It's a public group. Christians for now is moderated. It's moderated in terms of who can join it. You've got to be approved to join it. And undoubtedly, I will have to do that soon. But so far, it's not. I would like you to try it and to see if you can actually join it and stick something on there. Because even though that's been on my Facebook announcement page, I'll call it that now, no one has joined the group I don't think I am going to get as interactive with that. I've also got something going on Twitter. I don't think I'm going to get as interactive and back and forth with you, the Ham Radio Now community, as Christian and Katie are on their Facebook page. And that may be to the detriment of the total growth of the show. Probably I ought to do things like that. I'm probably not going to, but I don't know. I might. I think I'm missing the boat. There is something else that I want to point out. Let me go back to Christian's page for a moment, if I can find it. Where did I put you, Christian? There you go. This thing here, this 100 watts in a wire RSS, I've got the same thing on Ham Radio Now. It is an opportunity to put in our programs into your mobile devices, your phones or whatever, and automatically get the programs as they come out. And let's see, have I got the right button here? There we go. This is my phone, and this is my podcast app. It's the one I'm using is called Double Twist. There's a lot of podcast apps out there. Double Twist is a popular one. And these are all of the programs that I have subscribed to. I don't listen to all of them every day. Did I pass mine? Yeah, there we go. There's mine. Ham Radio Now. Christian's is up here somewhere. There he is. A lot of these start out on iTunes. And if they're on iTunes or a few other places, then you can do a search to find a podcast. Although when you do a search, my experience in doing a search like that is you get a lot of stuff, and often you don't get specifically what you're looking for, and maybe buried way down in a list, even though you're pretty specific on the name that you were looking for. So what you can do is put in something more tuned. You can see right here on the bottom, kind of covered up by little app that I've got that tells me what my upload and download is, which I think is very cool. It, you know, real-time upload and download speed indicator for data on my phone. I don't remember what the name of it is. I'll look it up. Somebody's going to ask about that. Anyway, add podcast by URL, and bump the microphone, which bumped the micro cam. Right in there, you would type in the RSS URL, which for Ham Radio Now is hamradionow.tv/HRNRSS/XML. And what that is a little XML file, little file that sits on my website that I update when I put a new program out. And your podcast app will query that as often as you want it to. Mine is set for like every 4 hours to go see what new shows have been announced. It will go to my website, look at that app. If it sees a new program, it will download it to your phone, or at least let you know that it's there and you can choose to download it. So if you've been missing Ham Radio Now shows, if you want to, and this is just for me, it's just audio. This is something you can do on the commute or whatever. I know it's kind of hard to sit here and watch a 1 to 2 hour program off of YouTube on your computer or video, or even if you put it up on the big screen. Time for doing that is limited. I don't watch very many shows, but I listen to a lot. And that's the way you can get Ham Radio Now and 100 watts in a wire by putting that into your phone and listening to us in audio. I'd say about half the Ham Radio Now shows are totally radio shows. And the other half are somewhere in between. A few of them are you know, very video oriented, but even those, I think you can get a lot out of them just by listening. Speaking of podcasts, Newsline is back, and Newsline is also one that you can subscribe to. We talked to Don and Don Wilbanks and Skeeter about Newsline. And when Bill had passed away in our Goodbye to Bill episode, they were looking for it coming back, and it's come back pretty quick. So you can subscribe to that on your phone. My phone is currently giving me a bit of a fit. Oh, there we go. Where have I got it? I don't remember where I've got it. This isn't exactly in alphabetical order. So it's in here somewhere. Oh, ARL Audio News, the e-letter, all available. Some of these are those other technical podcasts that I've talked about. And there we go. Amateur Radio Newsline. That's not what I was looking for, but that's another one that you can get. Must have pushed the wrong spot on the phone. Okay, so there we go. Amateur Radio Newsline. And they've got two new reports out. So the previous one before Bill passed away, stop it. That's going to start making noise again. the previous one before Bill passed away, May 22nd, and then they're back in July 10th and July 16th. And they are doing that shorter format. They're running 12 to less than 20 minutes so far. So they're managing to do that. Congratulations. Next, speaking of Don Wilbanks, and I got this from the last Ham Nation show last week. In the tail end of the program, when Amanda comes on and reads questions from the chat room, she got this one on D-Star on HF that she punted over to Don.
All right, D-Star on HF. Now, I have heard of this, but I am not completely familiar with it, and I think that you would be more familiar with it. And I'm trying to look for my question here as I'm trying to talk to you. And yes, how does D-Star work over HF? Is it considered a data contact? And what part of the band would you use, et cetera? I'm thinking about the D-Star ICOM radio. Now, I don't know what radio he's considering, but I have heard about this. Tell me more.
Yeah, that would either be the 7100 or the 9100. And that would be a great Ray Novak, N9JA question. He's in the chat room. He's probably probably typing feverishly as we speak. I think that you can use it in any part of the band because it is essentially audio. I mean, it's digital audio, but it's essentially audio. It's not actual. Well, I'm not sure. But I do believe that D-Star can be used in any part of the HF band. There are probably like gentlemen's agreements windows. And again, I'm kind of making this up as I go along. I'm telling you what I think I know. A quick Google search or send an email to Ray Novak. You can find him, N9JA, and Ray will tell you everything you need to know about D-Star HF, a lot more than I can tell you.
Okay, well, that's a start.
It is, Amanda. And I think I might be able to help, at least a little bit. The FCC classifies D-Star as phone. So it's legal any place in the phone bands, except for 60 meters. And that's even though half of D-Star signal is some kind of data. Some overhead, some forward error correction, 1,200 bits per second of pure ASCII data. And it's interleaved, you know, in terms of time. There's a little bit of data that makes up the voice, a little bit of data that makes up the overhead, a little bit of data that makes up the phone, or the ASCII data, and then back to voice. So it's all interleaved, but at least for now, the FCC is considering that to be phone. Evidently, phone is predominant. And so it's legal any place on the HF bands except for 60 meters. But if you're thinking about doing D-Star, getting a D-Star radio, one of the radios that will do D-Star on HF, or you can add modules to many current HF radios that will allow them to do D-Star, consider this. It is wide. It is 6.25 kilohertz wide, about the width of a typical AM signal. So you want to consider band occupancy before you start using D-Star on HF. We wouldn't want a lot of D-Star signals on HF up and down the band. And we wouldn't want 7 or 8 of them because they take up too much space. Just the way we wouldn't want 7 or 8 AM signals up and down the band. I think most bands have spot for 1 or maybe 2 that take up that much space. And, you know, an AM signal is typically 6 kilohertz, but it can be wider. If you limit your audio spectrum to 3 kilohertz, Your AM signal will be 60 kilohertz wide, but you don't have to. You can get higher fidelity. If you got one of these Heil microphones and you want to sound really good, you can go higher fidelity. Okay, so how do I know that it's phone? How do I know that it is legal? I don't know. I came across it someplace. I'm pretty convinced that this is all true, but I can't point to the documents right now. However, let's go down the rabbit hole. The emission designator for D-Star is 6K00F7W. 6K00F7W, as it says here on this this website. D-Star, 6 kilohertz bandwidth. There's some more details over here. This is on AA9VI's blog. And it is mostly aimed at DMR, but he does talk about D-Star quite a bit. And this is a, pretty much TLDR. Too long, didn't read. But down here it says, regarding that 6K00F7W designation, one can easily find an explanation for the designator on the web by performing a simple search. Boom. Simple search. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff out there, and none of it is simple. Let's start with this one from the ITU, the International Telecommunications Union. All right. This is a mess. The six. Section one, necessary bandwidth. The six is 6 kilohertz. Okay. I think I see that here somewhere. The K. The K has got me confused. Let's dial down here to section two, classifications. There's a K. Modulated in amplitude. Well, that's not right. D-Star is a digital signal. And no matter how the signal is being modulated, it is not amplitude. It is a consistent modulation. So it's not modulated in amplitude. So we're already, gone. What about the 00, 6K00? I don't completely lost here. I have no idea. I don't see any places for that. So I'm going to abandon this search and try this one. And, oh... This is from a website called Ominous Valve, ominous-valve.com. That already sounds bad, but it helps me a little bit because the K turns out to be not that K we saw on the previous website. It is just means kilohertz. So the 6K00 turns out to mean just 6 kilohertz, 6.00 kilohertz. So that's what it is. The F, do a little better with the F too. It's not AM. It is angled modulation, straight FM. And, we're all used to thinking that it's digital, but it is actually frequency modulation of digital information. That's really what D-Star is in its rawest form. Okay, so the F seems right, I guess. And the 7. Remember, we're dealing with 6K007-something. Two or more digital channels. Well, that seems right because we got that voice and then we've got that data, and then we got the overhead and voice and data and overhead. It seems to be two or more digital channels, but I really don't know if that's what it really means. So, Don, I'm going to join your club here. I don't know club. Okay, how about the W? What's in the W? And there we go. A combination of all of the above or some of the above Oral telegraphy? No, I don't think so. Any kind of telegraphy? No. Analog fax? No. But data? Telemetry? Data, yes. Telephony? Yes. Video? No. So combination of some of the above. So that one seemed to help out. Tell you what. FCC to the rescue. With this list of examples. But they don't list the example that we specifically want. And they cop out. If you have questions, right here, if you have questions about your emission designator, you may want to contact your radio vendor or manufacturer. Yeah, thanks, FCC. FCC is not to the rescue. So I give up. It's legal. It's wide. Use it carefully. And maybe think about FreeDV. FreeDV is only 1.2 kilohertz wide. I wonder what its emission designator is. Never mind. I'm going to go to Huntsville. I missed the Huntsville Hamfest last year. I've been there several years in a row. Missed last year. Really didn't have enough money to go. I don't have enough money to go this year either. Now I was kind of hoping that the Kickstarter made it. The Kickstarter goes into the general pot. And I will do the Tapper conference, but it gives a boost to Ham Radio Now in general. It may not make it, but I think I can just about squeeze in a trip. This is the Huntsville Ham Fest. It's going to be in Huntsville, Alabama, August 15th and 16th. It's a great ham fest. It brings in folks in the 5,000 to 6,000 range. It's all indoors, nicely air conditioned. You don't have to slog through a rainy, hot, steaming flea market. I don't know how I'm going to set up things for Huntsville. I don't know if I'm going to do the SIB, the studio. Remember the SIB, the studio in a booth? Did that at Huntsville a couple years ago. Did it at Dayton a little bit. It's a lot of stuff. I got to bring all of this stuff and all these cameras, and it's a lot of infrastructure to bring. But I might. I might just record forums. Forums a little bit easier. Just set up some cameras, let them record, and then edit them later. So a little bit more work on the editing side, but they're kind of easy to do, but they're not my content. They're somebody else's content. So, but I've looked over their list of forums and they got some interesting ones that I think you'd enjoy seeing. I may just run around and do some interviews like I did at Dayton, just carrying a couple of cameras and getting some interviews about. So maybe I'll see you at Huntsville. I am planning on going. There is that great field day story. Moving on, that great field day story that we saw in Ham Radio Now episode 208 with Sean and Katie.
What about today?
The ability to tinker, hands on.
I'm gonna put it
was from KHQ in Spokane, Washington. I got some feedback on that. We were speculating on the source of the expertise that was shown in the production of this and getting it all together. And it turns out that the producer of that for KHQ was the son of a ham. And I wish I could tell you more about that. But I searched my email. I didn't see the reference. I looked at YouTube. Didn't see the reference. I think that the comment was made on QRZ.com. And unfortunately, QRZ.com's forums are down. You'll see that if you go over there. By the time you see this, their forum should be back up. So maybe I should go over there and take a look. Did I set that up? Yes. There we go. The forums will resume soon. It's been a long outage. They were doing an upgrade. Everything crashed. Happened over last weekend. As I record this, it's already Wednesday, and it's still not working. So their lookups and all that stuff, that's all still working, but the forums are down. So I don't know how I'm going to announce this. In any case, I think that the comment on that video was made in a QRZ forum, and I can't go look at it. I can't go research it. So whoever sent that post, that information about their son doing the KHJ video, thank you very much. And thank him very much for getting the word out. The bottom line there is, the lesson is, use your contacts and resources to get the word out about ham radio. If you know somebody in the biz, lean on them a little bit. Let's see. Going to skip a few things because our time is too long, and we're going to go pretty much toward the end of what is going on. So speaking of how ham radio is perceived out there in the general public, there's this.
I've always wanted a ham radio set, and now that I've got one, I'm going to listen in on distress signals and notify the authorities and prevent disasters and noble things like that.
Part of the laugh track. Yeah, okay, so the Munsters. You know, I've always known that, at least I think I've been aware that there was a Munsters episode that had ham radio in it for a long time. Bits and pieces on YouTube. What I didn't know was that the episode that it came from is got a lot of ham radio in it. And evidently the producers and the folks that did this episode, they had some good contacts in ham radio. I don't know if anybody was a ham, except maybe somebody on the crew or somebody that they knew. But, I mean, they got a lot of interesting stuff. And what Herman just said, that I'm going to do public service, I'm going to help people, I'm going to handle emergency communications. It rings just a little bit too true. Comes a little bit too close to home. So what I discovered was that all of the Munsters is now available on Netflix streaming. I've got Netflix, so we can watch all of them. And the specific episode that has all of this ham radio stuff is episode 18. And the title of that is, If a Martian Answers, Hang Up. It was from 1965, I think January 1965, which is just when my fresh novice ham radio license arrived. And I think I was a Munsters fan. I really don't remember this episode from its original airing. And we've talked about my memory, so... could have watched it, but I would have thought that I would have remembered that. But in any case, yeah, if you've got Netflix, you can go watch the whole thing, and I recommend that you do. But back then, and I remember this, we were all very in awe and trembling, fear and trembling of the FCC. And what I didn't realize was the FCC held us in such high regard.
Washington on our latest ham operator application. The call letters are W6XRL4.
These two-way radio rigs are getting to be quite a popular hobby.
Yeah. I just hope this man realizes that being able to communicate with people all over the world carries a serious responsibility.
What's the name on this one?
Herman Munster, Mockingbird Heights.
Oh, I'm sure he's a solid citizen with both feet on the ground.
Yeah, we all are. Well, I was going to play some more, but, you know, the YouTube clip was plenty. I'll tell you what, one more, and this one is for Cindy.
What's this, a delegation?
We just came down here to get you away from that radio.
That's right, Herman. It's caused us nothing but trouble.
Yeah, Cindy. She saw that. I should have her on the episode, but she's got a real job. She's working today. If you got Netflix, you can watch the whole thing. I recommend it. I should get Netflix as a sponsor on Ham Radio Now. Finally, a comment on YouTube about the way that I sign off the programs. They all sign off the same way, pretty much the same way. And somebody was complaining once again that over and out. Well, tell you what, I've explained this before. Let me explain it again. Bob will be back next week with Ham Nation. In the meantime, I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I will say 73, and we'll see you next time. Over and out. You might remember my sign-off from last week. I told you somebody was going to get mad at me. Bill, K1ATV, Bill in Mesa, Arizona, and that's a Bill with one L, Bill. I'm paying attention, Bill with one L, says that at the end of the Ham Nation that I hosted back with the Carol Perry, that was, I believe, number 9, At the end of the show, I said over and out.
Oh.
Bill says, and you'll find this a lot in ham radio. People get picky about the way we do things. Bill says those are mutually exclusive.
Mm.
Over means you expect a response.
Mm.
Out means that you don't. And so over and out means you can talk if you want, but I won't be listening.
I don't know.
Evidently, over and out is sort of a Hollywood Hollywood take on to a radio communication.
It's a Broderick Crawfordism, yeah, we'll call it.
It could be.
Yeah.
It's a Dick Tracy, because I think he'd even, oh, went even farther. Yeah. 6-2 and even over and out. Remember that?
Yep.
So anyway, I think I'll go with the you can talk if you want. I'm not going to be listening.
I'm gone.
And I guess it's time to get out of here. So let me give you my new signature line, Gordon. Over and out.
You can't say
over
that.
Out.
10-4, good buddies.
You better get ready for bed now. I'll be up soon to say goodnight.
Roger,